Okay, so on this short PowerPoint here, what I thought I would do is for Unit 1 of Biology A, I've gone through and I've kind of tallied up the some of the questions on the three quizzes that people seem to miss more of than some of the other questions. And so what I'm going to do is just briefly cover some of that material so that you don't miss that when you go to take your quiz. So one of the things it does ask is, what does it mean to be alive? And certainly we know that, living things will all share some type of characteristics, and that we use these characteristics to determine if an organism is alive. Now, this author has eight that they are listing, and they feel that if something does not meet all these requirements, all eight, then they would not consider it alive. They would consider it to be an inanimate object. Now, as you look through here, you can see that I've highlighted in each paragraph what the kind of the main word is to kind of be considering as far as when you're thinking of something being alive or not. And so the first characteristic of all living things is that they're made of cells. So cells are kind of like that smallest unit that can sustain life. Okay, it can range. We can have an organism that's from just one cell, they call it unicellular, one cell, to multicellular. Now, those cells are made up of smaller units, and we're going to talk about that a little bit later. They are made up of molecules and other things, but units smaller than a cell are not considered life. So there's a picture of a cell there. Now, and that's highlighted, cells. Second characteristic we're going to talk about is that all living things will contain DNA. And we probably from other science classes we've taken or from biology, this is biology A. So probably at some time during your schooling in junior high, you've learned about DNA and that is a universal code where organisms store all the information that's used for all the body processes and everything that needs to be made. It's kind of like the blueprint for everything. And so you probably have learned that it's in the shape of a helix, so kind of like it's a ladder, but it's kind of like twisted. And maybe you've learned that it's made up of four bases here. You can see some of them here, the A, T, G, and C. So you can see that in here. And you can see that the A always binds with the T in DNA, and the G always binds with the C. So if you look through that, you can see that. Other than that, we don't really need to go any further right now. I just want you to know that so far, all living things are made of cells. All living things contain DNA. Now, the third characteristic is reproduction. So organisms need to be able to reproduce. They need to be able to pass on their genetic information in the DNA to their babies or to their offspring. Now, this can occur sexually, male and female. It can occur asexually, but somehow the genetic material needs to be passed on. Now, what's kind of interesting is asexual reproduction, certainly though, because you don't have the mating of the mom and dad or male and female, generally the offspring are genetically identical to that single parent, but there is a passing on of genetic information. So reproduction. Fourth characteristic would be that living things need to grow and develop. Certainly over here you can see that, let me see if I can move this over here. Maybe not. So you don't see the fourth stage here, but you can see as a baby, then getting bigger and getting bigger. All organisms grow to some extent, whether it be a tree that it grows from a little sapling to a giant redwood tree, or frogs that are an egg and then develop into the tadpole to the adult frog, human babies like we have a picture of here. Even single cell organisms will grow in size and abilities to some extent. So the fourth characteristic of all living things is growth and development. That little picture of that baby elephant is so cute. Now the fifth characteristic is that all living things they need to obtain and they need to use energy for all the processes that are going on in the body, in the cells. Now, this could be obtained from the environment by eating or absorbing it in some way. Let's see, anything else I wanted to say on this? All food is needed for all the chemical reactions, as I was saying earlier, and those chemical reactions are called metabolism. So you need to obtain, you have to have energy, get energy somewhere so that you can use it. Now, the sixth characteristic will be that all living things, even if it doesn't appear to your eye to do this, respond to stimuli, whether it be maybe if you're in a dark room, you walk into a real light room that the pupil constricts, depending on, because of all the light. Animals shiver in cold weather. Even bacteria have special receptors to enable them to sense things and respond to their environment. So on this page, we have obtain and use energy as far as being a characteristic of life, and that organisms can respond to stimuli in their environment. Seventh characteristic is that obviously all living organisms need to maintain a stable internal environment. We maintain our internal body temperature at about 98.6 or 37 degrees Celsius. We can't, we would die if our temperature goes up to 107, 108. So homeostasis is very essential in living organisms to regulate things like temperature. Water is another thing. We can't, even as humans, we have certain things dealing with our kidneys to maintain or excrete water. Sometimes those processes can certainly go awry. We may get very dehydrated if we don't drink water and stuff. But there are internal things that are in place to help maintain a stable internal environment. Even like talking about maybe being in the desert, so your temperature doesn't go up so high. What do? We sweat. That evaporation of the sweat from the body cools the body down. That's another mechanism for maintaining a stable internal environment. So living things need to do that. And the eighth characteristic that they talk about is that populations change over periods of time. We all have within our DNA certain possibilities to happen. Depending on the mating and what goes on, certain characteristics can actually be eliminated. We can't add any more than unless it's through a mutation that we begin with, and usually mutations are detrimental. But there are changes, whether it be humans, maybe in height. We've seen people are getting taller now than they used to be. And we can see this even in, humans have taken advantages of this by choosing preferred traits within dogs, resulting in hundreds of different types of breeds. So, changing of populations, and that seventh one is maintaining that stable internal environment. Now, another thing that was missed is that there are questions on whether photosynthesis only occurs in plants. What might be your answer off the top of your head? Usually we think, yeah, probably just occurs in plants, but really it doesn't. It actually can occur in algae. There are many species of bacteria in which photosynthesis can occur, where they are using carbon dioxide, water, sunlight to actually synthesize food. Okay, so it is not something that only occurs in plants. It does occur in other organisms, even though certainly plants are a major part there of who does it. And here, are atoms and some atomic particles, are they found in living and non-living things? Well, look at this gold here. I have a chunk of gold. Let's pretend that we just keep cutting it smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller till I get down to this, which is an atom of gold. So yes, that's non-living. Gold is non-living, and I certainly can cut it down so small that the last thing I come to is where it still has all the characteristics of gold is an atom of gold. So yeah, in non-living things we find atoms. Do we also find atoms in living things? Well, a good example would be, how about a molecule? Like in red blood cells, they usually contain many, many, many molecules of hemoglobin. And so these hemoglobin molecules are what actually carry the oxygen. So as your red blood cells are going through the circulatory system, the hemoglobin molecule is actually carrying the oxygen. Now I've broken it down over here so you can see the hemoglobin molecule. And if we go and look, there's carbon. Well, carbon is an atom. H, hydrogen's an atom. O, oxygen is an atom. So here we can see that if we break it down far enough, also living things You can find atoms and some atomic particles in living things also. So for some reason, I think people were only thinking that it's in non-living, but if we break it down further to the molecules, like here, we can see, yeah, molecules are made up of atoms, aren't they, of different elements. So are atoms and some atomic particles found in the living and non-living? The answer is certainly yes. So that's all we have, and this will be, like I said, some of the questions that people missed in quizzes 1, 2, and 3 in Unit 1. So I hope this helps if you are one that has chosen to watch this so that you don't miss it on your test. And thank you for watching. Bye-bye.